praise the name of Jesus. I surrender all to you.
Sales happen. You know, all companies
want to have you spend more money around this season. Rededication occurs around this season. It's a season where folks just kind of sit down and try to take stock, right? Of the fact that there's something about the season. Corporate America tries to take advantage of it, so you spend more. Churches try to capitalize on it because it's the season of Jesus. Amen? But I want us to look at this season by the grace of God from a homiletical approach, which is looking at things from the lens of God. Amen. You know, there are different lenses you can look at any issue from. But today, for this month, I want us to look at the Easter season from that approach, from an approach where, how does God see the season? Praise the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. There's a reason Christ came. We won't miss out on that reason in Jesus' name. So we have passionately termed this month and our series that we're going to be looking at this month, Faith and Forgiveness. Luke chapter 17. And please permit me to use a very, very old English language this morning. Amen. I typically would use the NIV version, the New International Version, or use the Message version of the scripture. But we're going to use this because I really want us to go through the same scripture together this morning. All right. So verse 1 says, then he said unto his disciples, it is impossible but that offenses will come, but woe unto him through whom they come. So if you don't have that underlined in your Bible, please underline the word impossible. And then let's go to verse 2. All right, so let me see if I can pull that up. So verse 2 says, it were better for him, and that's the him that Jesus said woe to, that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he cast into the sea, than that he should offend one of these little ones. Verse 3, take heed to yourselves. If thy brother trespasses against thee, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. Verse 4, very unique verse. And if he trespasses against thee 7 times in a day, and 7 times in a day turn again to thee, saying, I repent, thou shalt forgive him. Underline that phrase. Thou shalt forgive him. And verse 5. And the apostles said to him, Lord, increase our faith. Underline that as well. That's a big bothersome, isn't it? What has faith got to do with forgiveness? Jesus said to them, let us pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we ask, oh God, that you speak your word through me this morning. I pray that you prepare the hearts of your children to hear from you. And I also pray, Almighty God, that every word that is spoken here will land on good soil. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. To forgive doesn't come easy. Amen. Who agrees with me here? To forgive does not come easy. If it were easy, there would be no need for faith. I'm going on a journey this morning. It's not in the human nature to forgive. Because typically humans generally want to respond and get back at you for doing something that hurts. And if you look at it logically, you want to ask yourself, so what is wrong in that? The person was just sitting down doing their thing, minding their business, and this person from nowhere just hurt them, right? So the tendency of the human nature is to do exactly that. But there's a correlation between faith and forgiveness. Now, if you look at the life of Jesus, Jesus in his ministry on earth, about 3.5 years, walked every single day talking about faith and possibilities. Amen. Every opportunity Christ had, he would say, if you say to this mountain, be moved, have faith, oh ye of little faith, you must believe. And on this one occasion was the first ever time that the Son of God said something was impossible. Amen. Go back to verse 1. Reverend, verse 1. Of the same Luke 17. Verse 1 says, then it said unto the disciples, it is impossible but that offenses will come. This is the Son of God, the embodiment of faith himself, saying something is impossible. So, if I want to look at it logically, then it's a guaranteed fact that for you to live as a human being on this earth, people will piss you off. People will hurt you. People will offend you. Amen. We're going somewhere. Jesus uses, for the first time, impossibility to state a fact of what is guaranteed to happen, the reality of offenses. While it's a fact that we all are going to experience offenses one way or the other, people will step on our toes, you know, people will do things that piss us off. Jesus used a very, very strong word for the cause of the offense, for the offender. So Jesus is not, you know, letting responsibility fade away from the person who hurt you. Amen. Jesus is not doing that at all. So Jesus is saying here that I'm not saying the person who offended you is guiltless, but I want you to look at it from your responsibility's perspective. And that's what we're going to focus on. Amen. What's my responsibility as a child of God? And in verse 2, you notice that Jesus uses the phrase, you know, if you do something to any of these little ones. He wasn't in fact talking about children, because verse 1 says he was talking to his disciples. Peter had a wife and a mother-in-law. At least that we knew from the scripture. These were grown men. And you notice at times, you know, Paul will say, I speak unto you little children. It doesn't mean that he was emphatically talking about little children per se. It was just an analogy of those based on their walk in the faith. John also said it. John chapter 2 verse 1, little children, you know, I say unto you that you don't sin, but if anybody sins, you know, we have an advocate. So Jesus made it clear that the offender has a responsibility, and also the person that's offended also has a responsibility. And in our journey of growth as a Christian, we'll be offended by some of those that we look up to. Amen. Praise God. And all those who hurt you or all those that you heard, all those I heard, we've got a responsibility. That's why I'm extremely very cautious of how I deal with anybody that I deal with. Because at the end of the day, I may hurt you even without knowing. And Christ has placed a responsibility upon me. Should I offend you? Amen. Tell your neighbor or anyone close to you, you'll be pissed off at times because of what people will do to you. Amen. Let's open to Matthew chapter 18, verse 7. Matthew chapter 18, verse 7. Jesus was reiterating this fact. And then he said the same thing that he said. He said, woe to the world because of offenses, for it must needs be that offenses come. But woe to that man by whom the offense cometh. Verse 8. Wherefore, if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt or maimed, rather than having two hands or two feet and be cast into everlasting fire. And what Christ is trying to say there is this: if you're not careful, if we're not careful, there's a possibility that because of offense, a lot of Christians will miss heaven. How we deal with offenses, how we respond when somebody hurts us, how we deal with the issue of forgiveness. And that's why Christ made it a personal responsibility. He said, if your hand, whatever it is that's making you continue to walk in offenses, you better get rid of it. Because it has the tendency to cost us eternal life. So Peter tried to rope him in. Amen. Down the line, Peter then came to him and said, well, Jesus, you said if somebody offends me 7 times in a day, that should be cool, right? Because in Peter's mind, he said, listen, I'm going to match you all out at 7 times. By the 8th time, I'll body slam you. And Jesus said, oh, don't scold me. Because if you look at what Christ said in Luke 17, he said, somebody offended you 7 times in a day, all the 7 times, you forgive them. Jesus now said, you know what, let's put a number to it. He said, 70 times 7. Do we have some mad geniuses here? That's 490 times in a day. How is it possible that someone will hurt me 490 times in a day? Is that a possibility? Is that possible? No. So Jesus is trying to say to us that how we respond when somebody hurts us, intentionally or not, is extremely critical to our lives. Isn't it amazing, folks, that it's easier to believe in Jesus than it is to forgive somebody when they hurt you? It's actually very easy. The disciples said, whoa, 7 times 7 7 times in a day, nah, I don't think I can handle that. Father, increase our faith. How? So it presupposes that for us to be able to walk in God's demand for us to forgive when people hurt us, then we need faith to do it. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus requires both. For us to be able to forgive, we need to believe that it's possible. Praise God. In Luke 17, Jesus said, if your brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them. Oh, okay. So I can tell you exactly how I feel, and yes, they'll forgive you. Amen. Hallelujah. He said, if they repent, forgive them. I'm going to give us some sort of, you know, homework. Take that home. What happens if they don't repent? Jesus said, if somebody hurts you so bad and they repent, forgive them. If they offend you 7 times in a day, forgive them 7 times. If they offend you 490 times in a day, forgive them. But before you forgive them, you gotta hash it out. You have to rebuke them. Yo, you hurt me. The Bible says that we only sin. It said we can be angry and sin not. And not sin. The only time we sin is if we let the sun go down with the anger that we have in our heart towards somebody else. So the Bible gives us the opportunity to actually hash things out. Let's hash it out. Let's talk about it. For some of us who, you know, are learning every day to express our feelings. So, you know, it's a serious work in progress, I tell you. Because at times what I'm thinking is, oh, it comes out of my mouth. So I have to pause. So I don't use the wrong word that'll flesh somebody up. I'm like, oh shoot, that came out wrong, I'm sorry. Praise God. But take that home. And we're going to talk about it at some point. What happens if they don't repent? What do you do? Praise the Lord. The apostle said, increase our faith. And Jesus made one of the most profound statements that is made. Verse 6 of Luke chapter 17. The Bible said, he replied, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you. A lot of times we've quoted that scripture for the massive things, right? If you say to this mountain, move, let every big issues, you know, move in my life and things of that nature. But the truth of the matter is, Jesus made that statement in response to the issue of faith and forgiveness, because the disciples said to him, you have to increase our faith because it's impossible, humanly speaking. And let's be real, church, by human standards, 7 times. I've got the first time. Let's call the spirit. If somebody hurts you so bad, just the one time, you struggle to forgive them. Praise the Lord. By the 7th time, I'm not even interested in what you have to tell me. I just shut down. Church, we're talking about faith and forgiveness. What's the correlation? And Jesus said here this morning to us, he's saying, guys, all you need is a little faith, actually. You don't need as much. It's not a major mountain that you can't handle. That's why I used that correlation. I know, just the faith as small as a mustard seed. If I'm holding a mustard seed on the tip of my finger, nobody here will be able to see. It's that small. So who has pissed you off so much that you said to yourself, I'll never forgive this person? You are not hurting that person, you're hurting yourself. Amen. That's why they said increase our faith. Church, can we say to God this morning, Father, increase my faith? A lot of us will have faith for everything else but forgiveness. And do you know, oftentimes it's easy for you to have faith for somebody else when somebody else is going through their stuff. Then you can have faith for them. What do you do when you're the one involved? It's easy for us to believe Jesus. Have faith for everything else except forgiveness. These two spiritual values, faith and forgiveness, they're inseparable. Amen. They're inseparable. The Bible says that for this reason the Son of God was made manifest, that it might destroy the works of the devil. Right? But I've often asked myself, what was the work of the devil that Christ came to destroy? Who knows? Who wants to give it a shot? I'll make it easy. The devil came to the earth to throw a wedge between us and God. Eternal separation. That's why reconciliation is the reason why Christ came. So Jesus came so that we can be reconciled back to God and receive forgiveness through faith. The Bible says, by faith, we receive forgiveness. Then we need to take the issue of reconciliation extremely seriously. We cannot have a great relationship. You can't purport to me that you have a great relationship with God, or that you, if you walk in unforgiveness and you hold people in your heart. God doesn't live in such places. Amen. Praise the Lord. I can take anybody on earth up on that. No matter your bishopry, your level of spirituality, whatever that is. If you have an unforgiveness in your heart, God doesn't dwell there. And God is trying to challenge us this morning to let people go. Amen. To let people go. If you let people go, you can serve God. God said to Egypt, said, let my people go that they may serve me. God is saying to us, you let them go so you can serve him. Amen. Anybody you hold in your heart, they prevent you from serving God the way you should. Faith and forgiveness. I'm not here to tell you it's easy. Trust me, I've been dealt multiple hands. And it's difficult if it's the same person. Let's call it spade a spade. Right? You're trying to move on. And this person throws you another curveball. Boom. And you're scratching your head. I'm still trying to move on. Is it? Let me ask you a question this morning, church. Can you forgive and forget? Let's be real. Can you forgive and forget? Yes. Is it possible? Is it possible to forgive and forget?
No.
Yeah, do one more.
I think the fact that you don't forget is what makes the forgiving that much more effort. If you forget, then you didn't forgive.
All right, Spartan.
Interaction session. So I actually think it's possible to forgive, but it's hard to forgive. Like when they mess up, my kids mess up, I can't forget what they did, but I could definitely forgive them. I'm just something simple like that. But I don't think I can forget.
All right, so what is the test of full forgiveness? If you know, at what point do you then know that I've truly forgiven this person?
No, because when you forget something, you're forgetting. I want to testify to somebody else. So I have to remember to mess up and mess up in order for me to testify. That's what I
do. All right, who else? We're going somewhere. Go ahead, Brother T.
I think
there are
a lot of forgetting things. Somebody did something to you. That person, if there is a situation, maybe you're supposed to offer some kind of help, and so the person messed up. Now, the idea of forgetting is, I think the idea of forgetting is, if that same situation presents itself, if you did forgive and forget, you're supposed to go through it again, not minding if that person is still going to hurt you.
So you make yourself vulnerable. Who else? Yes.
I think it's possible to forgive and forget. After a while, if you forget your person, you're going to start forgetting what the person did that hurt you. But like, it's not, you're not going to feel the pain anymore. I feel like you see, even if you forget it, you still feel the pain of what the person did. And yeah, that's what the problem is. You have to let go of the pain.
Okay.
Well,
firstly, me.
Okay.
Alright, first lady.
Woo! Come on now.
Okay.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So whilst I don't know if this is part of what you're going to say, I read ahead of Luke 17. So I read 7-10. And then I read 7-10. And honestly, I've actually never seen it. I don't think I've ever read that scripture before. I haven't seen it this way. The truth of the matter for me, and I'm a work in progress. I'm a work in progress. I honestly think it's not necessarily easy to forget. It's not easy for me to forget. I want to speak for myself. I think ultimately the history books is there for a reason, to keep records. But the Bible also says you don't keep records of wrong, you know, if you truly have love. So in answer to PDJ's question about how do you then really know that you're forgiven, I think if I'm able to relate with you without any inhibitions, if I don't just totally stop dealing with you, then I know that I have forgiven and I have moved on. Praise the Lord.
So church, the reason this is healthy for us is this. Every time you look at the issue of forgiveness, right, from a human willpower, you miss it. It's impossible to. Amen. So, somebody borrowed money from me some time ago. Until today, they've not paid back. I was not happy. Right? But the truth of the matter is, I let it go. The person doesn't even remember that they haven't paid me back. I don't think they remember. So they've come again and again to say, can you borrow me money? I said, no, I can't borrow you, but I have this. If it's $50, I can give you. But I will borrow you money again. Does it mean that I hold the person in my heart? Right? So we need to really practicalize the issue of forgiveness, because if I see that person is in need, like desperate needs, would I look away? No. I will help them. I will try to help them the best I can. Amen. Whatever I have to give, I can give. I'll even try to give them ideas of how they can add to it from another source. So instead of borrowing money all over the place, right? Just get somebody to give you, get 10 people to give you $50 each. That's your $500 right there. You don't owe anybody. Praise the Lord. But every time you see that person, if something rings on the inside of you from an animal's perspective, you haven't truly forgiven. Because to forgive and forget means to truly forgive, so that when you see that person, the first thing you remember is not the hurt that they did to you. It doesn't happen by willpower. It takes faith in Christ. Amen. All right, so the question is, what do I do when I'm hurt? Let's be practical. What do I do when I'm hurt? First, acknowledge the pain. Praise the Lord. You know, a lot of relationships are founded on a faulty foundation because they're not able to express themselves exactly the way they feel. For whatever reason, amen. But it frustrates me. I've done something to offend me, and I can't really say, listen, you hurt me in this way. And she doesn't give me an opportunity to actually even say, you know, what she did wrong to me. Then the problem then becomes, I'll just be stomaching it one day, boom, you just explode. Praise the Lord. Right? So you have to acknowledge the pain that somebody did something wrong. If I know it all the time, nah. It's going to be building up. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Sometimes it's hard to admit that you've been hurt because doing so intensifies the feelings. Amen. So you really want to get rid of it now. So so it doesn't intensify the feeling. But you have to acknowledge the pain. You won't be able to walk through the pain until you admit that you heard it. Praise the Lord. At times, people, while trying to express themselves, just burst into tears. They've been truly hurt. Praise the Lord. So if you feel that way, you have to admit it. Amen. Because that's the step one of being able to go through the forgiveness process to forgive the person that hurt you. Number two, think through the pain. Think it through. What do I mean? Be honest about how you feel. Even if you feel you shouldn't feel that way. Amen. You know there's some feelings you can't admit to, so they don't think I'm not born again anymore. But you can, you should think it through. Admit how you feel. Admit that you don't like what happened or how somebody treated you. Admit that it made you sad or angry.